On the highway of life, there are those with a divine purpose and those that just wander aimlessly. Come see what purpose God has for you. You can be a witness for Christ, regardless of what you're doing or not doing.
They are in need of someone to come and help with children's church. If you know anybody, or maybe if God is tugging on your heart to serve, that would be a great opportunity for you to help in that as well. And speaking of opportunities to serve, our Apples of Gold, which is our secretarial ministry here at our church, is also looking for servants as well. Please, again, please pray about this. If God is tugging on your heart to serve here at HBC, hey, it doesn't have to be females. Guys can do this too, you know. I'm sure, guys, you know how to answer a phone? Yeah? Guys? No? All right, then. All right. but those servicing will be Monday through Friday from, what is it, 9 till
1.
What?
Till 1.
Till 1. 9 a.m. till 1 o'clock, Monday through Friday. You get to pick the days. You get to choose, you know, once a week or whatever days that you guys want to serve for. Also, we also need somebody for Sunday morning from 8 a.m. to 10:30, because we do have people that call the church looking for information for service times as well. So if you are interested in serving, there are connection cards in front of you that you can fill out and just put in one of our offering boxes, and somebody will definitely get a hold of you. If you are new to HBC and you have yet to be mugged, please go over to the find one of the ushers or deacons, and they will gladly give you some information about our new to HBC. We're going to be having a new to HBC meet and greet on May 22nd, but you'll need to call the church in order to make that appointment. Is that correct? We're still doing that? Yes? Okay, great. Perfect. So again, if you are new to HBC and you would like to be a part of that, call the church, make the appointment. It'll be for May 22nd. Also on May 22nd, we're going to be having, after second service, a meeting for anybody that wants to be involved with this year's VBS. It's our Vacation Bible School Outreach to the Youth. So if you're interested in being a part of that, May 22nd, we will be having a meeting after second service. So at this time, if you guys would please politely silence your cell phones, we will go ahead and get into worship, and we'll go ahead and lead off with prayer. Lord, Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this amazing time that we have gathered together in your name. Lord, we just ask that you come before us, Lord, or let us come before you, Lord, and give you song and praise. And Lord, we just thank you that we have this opportunity to be in your house, to worship you freely. Lord, may it be something that we don't take for granted. And Lord, may it just soften our hearts and prepare it for the message that you have for us today. So be with our pastor as he delivers that for you, Lord, and we can take that out into the battlefield. But Lord, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the women in our lives, Lord, and we just lift this time of praise and worship to you. In your son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand.
We're calling out to you.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that love, your love was sent down, Lord, to save us, Lord, to offer us grace and forgiveness. And Lord, we thank you that we can know you, Lord, that we can have a relationship with you, Lord, that we can know your love, Lord, that has no bounds, that is unconditional, Lord, that loves us just the same when we're walking close and when we're straying. Lord God, thank you for your mercy and grace. And I pray that we would soften our hearts, put down the walls as we continue to worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lying in limb, see. Yes, Lord, we thank you for your greatness, your goodness, your loving kindness, Lord, your faithfulness, Lord, your power, your strength, your provision, your guidance, Lord, and most of all, your love. And so, Lord, this morning, we just thank you. We praise you. Lord, you are worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor. You're worthy of every song we could ever sing, everything that we could ever offer to you, Lord. And most, the thing that you want most is our heart. And so, Lord, we come before you offering our heart this morning. And so, Lord, thank you, praise you, and honor you. In Jesus' name. And all God's children said? Amen. Awesome. That's a good worship. Good morning. How are y'all doing? Hey, happy Mother's Day. In case you didn't know, I just thought I'd let you know that. Well, listen, this morning, we're taking a break, obviously, and I'm doing a message entitled, Mother, May I? And mothers, may I honor you for a moment? Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. We're going to be all over the place in the Bible. We just want to celebrate you moms. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. I'm going to read from the NIV. It says, honor your father and mother, so that it may be, if you need a Bible, the ushers are there to give you one. Okay, honor your father and mother, so that you may live long in the land, and the Lord your God, that the Lord your God has given you. So here's the thing. Why does it say honoring your father and mother is going to lengthen your life? Because if you don't honor them, they're going to kill you. No, actually, the reason why honoring your father and mother is so important is because it is the basis of our society. When you have children that grow up to honor their father and mother, you end up with a very, very prosperous family and land. And when you have kids that don't honor father and mother, then you start to see the decay of a nation and of a people and of a family. So it is very important. And within that father and mother dichotomy, we have mom. Mom is very important, especially if you are a praying mother. Listen, a praying mom has more influence than you can imagine. And ladies, I pray, if you are a mother, or listen, praying for your mother, that's a wonderful thing. I know Abraham Lincoln said this, excuse me, no man is poor who has a godly mother. Prayerfully like me, some of you had a godly mom, a mom who was praying for you. Now, mother's love, we're going to talk a lot about a mom's love here this morning. Excuse me a second. But people say this, love is blind. And it's true, especially for a mother's love. You ever hear someone also say, he has a face that only a mother could love? That's kind of a put down for the son, but you realize that's a put up for the mom. Why? That just speaks to the fact that moms don't look outwardly. Mom looks at the heart. Every mother just sees good in their children. You can have an unruly child, but that mother will love that child. And by the way, I gotta be honest, not all babies are beautiful. I mean, they're all cute, but every mother thinks her baby is the cutest, the most beautiful. And they're like, here, Pastor, look at my baby. And you're like, whoa. Isn't she lovely? Oh, she. It's a she. Boy, she's something. that's rare. I mean, most, I would say 99% of babies are adorable. But every mother thinks that her baby is the most adorable. Now, today we are celebrating moms, your mom, or if you are a mom. It's Mother's Day. Well, where did it all begin? Well, Anne Garvis at St. Andrew's Episcopal in Gaffton, West Virginia, she moved to implement a day to honor her mother, to honor all the mothers in their church. Now, at the time, it was 1914, President Woodrow Wilson found out that they were doing this Mother's Day honoring at this particular church, and he declared on May 9th, 1914, the first Mother's Day ever. And then it was so received that it's now spread to many parts of the world. Now, what's interesting is as for Anne Garvis, she never married. She never became a mother herself. But her mother had so impacted her life that honoring mothers has now become something that is done every year. And why not? Mothers are so valuable. One person said this: if I had a single flower for every time I think of mom, I could walk forever in a garden. And it's like, that is beautiful. I don't know about you, but my mom's in heaven, but there's quite often that I just think my mom, you know, it kind of helps that I have a huge picture of her in my office. You know, I was telling my wife, you know, I used to call my mom after service every Sunday and tell her how it went, because she was very proud of the work God is doing here. And the other day, you know, a couple weeks ago, we had a great service, a great Sunday, and I stood up and I saw the picture and I started talking to the picture. And I stopped myself. I said, "What are you doing, Randy, Pastor Randy?" The Bible's very clear. We speak to the living. And those who have passed on, they're not watching. They could care. Well, I'm not saying they could care less, but they're so enthralled with heaven and glory. My mom is dancing before the Lord. She's not going, "Oh, what's Mijo doing?" She's not concerned. So I was like, "What are you doing, Pastor Randy?" And so I quickly stopped and praised God for being so good and that I know where she is. But we see in Scripture, God uses women for powerful, meaningful, impactful work. Eve, yes, I know she messed up. But she is the mother of us all. Jochebed, you know, Moses' mother, she sacrificed. She gave it. She was like, to protect her child, she was willing to send him off to be with someone else just as long as he would survive. And thankfully, she got to raise her child. You know how hard that must have been to raise a child and not for that child not to know that you're his mom? How about Ruth? Ruth is a part of the lineage of David. And then, of course, the lineage of the Messiah. Esther, oh Lord, for such a time as this, she preserved all of the Jews. And she was a good mom. And of course, we come to Mary. And we'll talk about her quite a bit. Mary, the mother of Jesus, the mother of our salvation. Think about that. So we see multifaceted essence of woman. A woman, you'll go from a girl to a woman, from a woman to a wife, from a woman who is a wife to a woman who is a mom, has a baby. You become a mom. Now, it's interesting because as women, as you become mothers, the men become gophers. Go for this, go for that. But mothers are to be honored. I think of, in the Bible, Solomon, right? Solomon considered the wisest man who ever lived. Look at how he responds to his mom. Over in 1 Kings, chapter 2, verse 19, and it says this: Bathsheba therefore went unto King Solomon to speak unto him for Adonijah. And the king, look, the king rose up to meet her and bowed himself unto her and sat down on his throne and caused a seat to be set for the king's mother, and she sat on his right hand. Now, first of all, sitting someone on your right hand was a seat of power and of authority next to the king. That was like the next to the king, that was the highest ranking. But what I really want you to notice here is that the king, before his mother, humbled himself and gave her honor. He bowed down to her. That was unheard of for a king. A king would not bow down to anyone. He's king. But here we have the wisest man recognizing that a mother is worthy of honor. The king wasn't ashamed to give value to his mom. Yeah, I remember when I first became an assistant pastor, I didn't know. You know, it was new. It was like I was all giddy. I'm like, well, I'm assistant pastor. What do I do? How do I act? What, you know? And so here we were at church, and my mom was there, and my dad, and, you know, people were like, congratulations, and all this stuff. And my mom comes up to me, and she's so proud of me. She says, oh, mijo. Mijo, that's what, you know, okay, that means my son in Spanish, right? She goes, oh, mijo. And I go, Mom, I'm a pastor now. She goes, oh, I'm sorry, Pastor Mijo. I don't care about titles. I was new. I didn't know. You know, I was like, I love my mom. Pastor Mijo. Right, exactly. She wouldn't do that. She loved me. But, you know, I also remember a time, and I'll never forget this, and there are a few times that you ever have those situations where you don't know why, it's just etched in your mind. So here I am in elementary school. My mom was a waitress. Now, if you know my mom, she's just a character. She's just outgoing. And so she was a waitress, and it was St. Patrick's Day. And so for work, she had herself a green derby and green earrings, and she had a shamrock on her face, big old shamrock she put on her face for St. Patrick's Day. Well, she had to come to the school to drop something off for me in his elementary school, and she walked in, and I was so embarrassed. All my kids were like, hey, your mom's cool, because she had the green derby, and she was all dressed up for St. Patrick's Day. But I was embarrassed of my mom, and now what I wouldn't give to have my mom walk through the door dressed like that, just one more time. But to a mom, her children are always her children, no matter how old or how large they become. One mother said, put it this way, let me love you a little more before you are a little, you're not little anymore. Let me reread that. I'm getting blurry here with these, whatever. Let me love you a little more before you're not little anymore. There you go. See, that's a mother's heart. By the way, did you know Jesus taught us to honor your mother? Turn with me if you want. John 19. Verse 25 through 27. Jesus is on the cross. He's been brutalized. He's thirsting. He's hungry. He's tired. He's dying. The worst possible death in human history. And look what happens. Verse 25. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus, therefore, saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, that would be John, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to his disciple, behold your mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. Now, that's intense. They say that during wartime, some of the most virile, strong, just brute of a man will be in the foxhole crying for his mommy. Here, Jesus on the cross, beaten, rejected, separation from the Father on a spiritual level, and he's totally honoring his mom. Mom, he's like, I'm worried about you. I'm concerned about you. John, you take care of her. Wow, talk about selfless. In all that turmoil, all he could do was consider his mom, take care of mommy, not mommy, take care of me. Most people in lesser turmoil can think of nothing else but themselves. The Lord Jesus Christ is concerned for his mommy. Perhaps that was the true first Mother's Day, by honoring his mother even unto death. Actually, it's an example for all of us not to take our mothers for granted. Do you realize, by the way, speaking of Mary, she is the only woman who is telling the whole truth, the only woman in history that was telling the whole truth when she would say, oh my Jesus, he's such a good boy. Every other mother says that. No, I have to say, no, there's none good. Not even little Johnny or little Sally. I'm sorry. Can you imagine what it was like for her? You know, I often picture, you know, there was a time when Jesus held her, his little hands held her fingers, and she was helping him to walk, take those first steps. Can you imagine what Jesus' giggle was like? He cried because he needed to be changed. She was 100% accurate when she said her Jesus was a good boy. One mother said this, I gave you life, but in reality, you gave me mine. That woman there is saying, you know, my children gave me life. They gave me reason. They gave me a new title, mom, mommy. But for Mary, that is beyond true. For her to say to Jesus, I gave you life, but in reality, you gave me mine. Why? Because he's the Savior, even of Mary. Now, side note, and I have to do this, I have to, every time we talk about Mary. The Lord Jesus, he didn't say, John, take care of my mom, Mary, and don't forget to pray to her. No, the Lord Jesus honored his mom. He didn't venerate his mom. Mary doesn't say, no, wait, Jesus, I'm Mary, full of grace. I will take care of myself. No. She realizes that she needs to listen to her son, the Savior. Yes, was Mary blessed? She was blessed among women. She was highly favored among women. Why? She is the only woman ever to give birth to the Messiah. Only one that ever will, only one that ever has. In that sense, she is favored. But she is not to be venerated. She is still 100% human. She is still in need of Jesus to save her, just like any other mom in this room. But wow, can you imagine, ladies, to give birth to the Messiah of all mankind for all eternity, and he's the one that actually holds your molecules together, and you give birth to him, and he's dependent upon you, Almighty God? That's a thought and a half. That's something that'll blow your mind if you think too long, so let's move on. But mothers, ladies, if you've got a mother, a godly mother, you got to admit she's had an influence in your life. Maybe you didn't always appreciate it, but she did. And if you are a mother, by all means, please, please be a praying mom. What is the legacy that you're leaving? Are you leaving a legacy for your children where they go, you know what, my mom prayed for me? There was a little kid coming home from church. He was crying. And his mom said, honey, why are you crying? And the little boy said, because of what the pastor said, because of what he prayed. Mom looked and said, did he pray something wrong? Yes, he said he wanted every child to grow up in a Christian home, but I want to live with you. It's funny. But it's an indictment. A mother and a father, but right now we're focusing on moms. Moms, you can have a powerful influence on your kids. There's a Jewish proverb, and understand this is a Jewish proverb. It's not scripture because here's what it says. God couldn't be everywhere, so he gave us moms. Now, that is a sweet sentiment, but bad theology. God is everywhere, and he still gave us moms. But God gave you a mom, and God gave some of you to be moms so that you can leave a legacy, so that you can influence your children. Will your child say as they grow up, you know, I was a horrible son or daughter, but my mom was praying for me. Listen, my mom prayed for me. I know she did. She prayed for me when I was on drugs. My mom prayed for my dad when he was dealing drugs and he was dealing with the mafia. My mom, I remember being there and hearing her crying and praying to God to keep her husband safe even though he was ungodly. And my mom prayed for me. I remember one time, and this breaks my heart to think back on it, my mom came reluctantly to me and she goes, Mijo, oh yeah? She goes, I'm afraid of you. You're scary. I praise the Lord that the day she passed away, she wasn't afraid of me anymore. Because she had prayed for me, because I believe it was her prayers that led me to Jesus. I believe it was her prayers that tore down that monster that I was and made me at least, you know, a person who's willing to listen to God and eventually surrender my heart. Ladies, what a legacy you can leave when we pray for our children. Women, you have something in you that is so unique that us men, you have a nurturing heart. You have a nurturing spirit. Now, some men come to me, Pastor Randy, I'm a nurturer. You know, I raised my kids alone. I understand that. But I'm sorry. I know in today's society they have a real difficult time of trying to define a woman. But I'm going to tell you, men, you're not one. Now, you may be able to raise your kids alone, and you may love them very much, but you don't have the same nurturing spirit that a woman has, and we'll talk about that here. One of my favorite pastors, Ken Graves, Calvary Chapel, Bangor, Maine. If you ever want to hear him, once you hear him, you'll never forget him. Amazing pastor, but he's a man's man. I mean, he's mad. He's a rule, right? So he says, when my kids would fall down and get hurt, and they'd come to me, and he'd say, get up, we're walking off. You know, it's like, we'll sew that finger bat on back on. He says, you know, my kids wanted, he said, my kids wanted me to kiss a boo-boo. My kisses don't have magic. Go to your mother. Her kisses have the magic. That's true. In fact, we see that sentiment, that idea, even in Scripture. Watch, 2 Kings chapter 4. In 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 18 and 19, it says this. And the child grew. Now it happened one day that he went out to his father to the reapers. So his father's doing work. His father's working, and the son goes out there, and he said to his father, my head, my head. So he said to the servant, carry him to his mother. In other words, my kisses don't fix. I got work to do. You carry him, he'll be all right. Well, evidently, eventually, the little boy died, or young man died, but Elisha comes and revives him, and it's a beautiful story. But the woman was smart enough and godly enough to carry the boy to Elijah so that she could take him before the Lord. But the idea is this. Even that man knew that mom had the nurturing. It's natural. Men, we are not nurturers. One thing I don't get, ladies, and I did a much more detailed list. I'm just going to give you a quick hit. A woman will say, I want a strong man who will protect me and yet sensitive enough to cry with me. What would that look like? Right? You're being harassed by some guy and your man comes and says, hey, leave her alone or I'll cry. just messing. I know what you want. Sidney J. Harris says this: the commonest fallacy among women is that simply having children makes them a mother, which is as absurd as believing that having a piano makes you a musician. See, anyone can become a parent, but to become a mom is like becoming a musician. It takes time. It takes dedication. It gets getting to know the fine tuning of your instrument. You know, they've done studies, and they say that a baby will have different tones of cry that can indicate different things. Like when the baby is hungry, there's a tone in their cry. When a baby needs to be changed, there's a tone. When they're sleepy. And mothers get that. I don't. I just hear crying. It's like, oh, gosh. But a mother goes, oh, he's just hungry. And that's exactly, mother has a keen ear for the tones of a child's heart. Why? They were connected. Women and their baby are connected. Us men, we go, oh, I felt a kick. Yeah, but you didn't feel a kick from the inside. You didn't give birth. The baby wasn't living off your nutrients. One person defines a mom this way: one person who does the work of 20 for free. That is true. That is so, so true. But here's the thing. There's an incredible aspect of motherhood. And men, here's where I can definitely prove to you that we don't nurture the same way. Jesus put it this way. In John 16, Jesus speaking, verse 20 and 22. A woman, when she is in labor, has sorrow. Now, this sorrow means suffering pain, not sorrow like you're crying for a loved one who's dead. No, you're about to give birth. But this sorrow means suffering pain. Okay? A woman, when she is in labor, has sorrow because her hour has come. Now, ladies, I've never given birth. Is it sorrowful, painful? Yeah? No? It's not too bad? I asked last night, and it was like, they were like, the only one who said yes was some dude. He goes, yes, it's painful. I'm like, I was like, are y'all awake? So is it painful? Yeah. Thank you. Yay. All right. So it says this: but as soon as she has given birth to a child, she no longer remembers the anguish for the joy that a human being has been born into the world. Therefore, you now have sorrow, pain, but I will see you again. Your heart will rejoice, and your joy no one can take from you. Now, how in the world, and this is what Jesus is saying, how in the world, and I say this all the time, does a woman give birth all that pain and go, may I have another? Yes, when a girl, you can tell the difference between a girl who's had several babies. It's like, yeah, it's my fifth one. It's like no big deal walking around. It's like, whoa. But the gal who's having her first baby, she walks slow. She's worried about what it's, because she's never endured that pain. You ever go to those Lamaze classes and see the movie they show? I call it fetal attraction. It's like, every woman's like, oh, that's so beautiful. Every guy's like, whoa, whoa. That's intense. Motherhood. What Jesus is saying in that verse in John 16, what he is saying is that motherhood has the power and the beauty that is comparable to God's love. What do I mean? Well, let's look at it real quick. Go back to John 16, verse 21. A woman, when she is in labor, has sorrow because her hour has come. Remember Jesus in the garden? And he prayed. He had this sorrow. And then, of course, he endured the cross. And Hebrews 12, 2 says this: looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus on the cross suffered pain. A mother in her pregnancy and delivery suffers pain. There is stress. There is sorrow. leading up to the actual labor, right? Just like Jesus, Luke 22:44, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great droplets of blood falling down on the ground. Jesus was sweating. Do you realize it was cold outside? Because in Mark 14:16, it tells us that Peter was warming his hands. You ever have a night so cold that you're warming your hands? So Peter's warming his hands. Jesus on that same night is praying in the garden, and he's sweating. The hematidrosis, the capillaries under the skin bursting, and water mixed with blood coming down. Isn't that like a mother in the delivery room? Delivery rooms are oftentimes cold, yet she's sweating, and there's blood, just like Jesus. But the Bible tells us, but for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. You might as well say, for the joy that is set before her, she endures the birth. It's a paralleled love. Just as a mother endures the pain in anticipation of the wonderment of receiving her newborn baby into her arms, Jesus endured the cross with the anticipation of the wonderment of receiving a newborn believer into his arms. I love that. Yet for Mary, it's a paradox, right? She suffered pain to give birth to the one who would suffer pain to give her new birth. Wow. Mary gave birth so that she could be born again. Ladies, you can relate to Jesus like this. Can we turn this one up a degree? Because it is cold. This side of me is freezing. This side of me is comfortable. So how does that work? Someone on that? Thank you, sir. Psalm 127, verse 3. Behold, children are the heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is his reward. It's your reward. It's his reward. By the way, it's men's reward too. It is. But God is has planted a yearning in the heart. He has equipped you women with a special expression of love. Even if you don't have children, you still have that nurturing. If you're married and you don't have children, you do have children. It's called your husband. Him a big baby, him do. He wants to be nurtured. Men, your mom, your sister, your bride, we're created with a different kind of nature, a different kind of love. And by the way, we need to understand it. In fact, over in 1 Peter, it tells us that men, you are to dwell with them with understanding. Why does the Bible tell us that? Because we don't understand. The Bible tells you. You go, oh, I understand. The Bible says, no, you don't. But you have to dwell with them with understanding. Try and find some. But being a full-time mom, that's intense. It's the highest paying job that anyone can have because it pays in pure love. There's not a higher dividend. There's nothing that is greater than being paid with love. I'll take love over money any day. But why shouldn't it, right? Having a baby, carrying that baby, that's intense. Raising a baby is exhaustive. And then, of course, everyone loves their child for a lifetime. God placed that yearning in y'all. He did. He's equipped you. He has equipped women to long to express that nurturing. One lady said this. Just when you think you know love, something little comes along and reminds you how big love can get. I love that. That is beautiful. A mother's love, a wife's love, a sister's love, a woman's love. There's a sweetness, there's a gentleness to it. It's beautiful. But when God puts a man and woman together, love becomes this new thing. It's called a life. Now, a mother's love is unconditional, and by the way, so should a father's love be, but we're talking about mothers right now. But a mother's love is that 1 Corinthians 13:7 love. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. And isn't that what a mom does for her children and her husband? You know, you can have a mom who has an unruly child, or maybe even a criminal child, teen, or young man. And you talk to that mom, and all she could see is the best. Well, not my little boy, not my little girl. They would never hurt anybody. Because she bears all things and believes all things and hopes all things. It's a special love. It has to be special to want a baby. Why don't you go, come on, Pastor Eddie, you don't like babies? Babies are cool. I love my kids. You know, I love them. You know, I loved Plastens. I love my kids. I love them more now that we can, you know, communicate and I can mess with their minds. I love that part. But the goo goo gagas and the, understand, on paper, rationally think of having a baby, right? Sleepless nights, mess, all that stuff, logically, career, if you have career-minded, financially raising a baby is incredibly expensive. Physically, ladies, it takes a toll on your body. There's no way you can go through that and not have a toll. So on paper, it makes no sense. Why? Well, because I have rational logic financially and physically. There's something missing from the list. What is that? Love. See, love doesn't count the cost. Love just dives and goes for it. When you add love to the mix, all of a sudden, having a child is totally rational. It's not just rational, it's longed for. Because love doesn't look at the cost. Love will throw caution to the wind. That's why, by the way, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27 says, "But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise." Before I was saved, I thought the cross was stupid. Some guy gets ripped apart, hanging on a cross. What is that all about? Until I fell in love with Jesus. And then it was like, thank God for the cross. It makes sense to me now. Having a baby makes no sense on paper. It looks foolish until you go, but love, I'm going to love that little baby. I'm going to raise that little baby. It's going to be a, you know, for the guy, chip off the old block. For a woman, it's going to be a part of you. Love says, I don't care about the cost. Love says, I don't care about sleeplessness. Love says, I don't care about the pain. Isn't that how Jesus loved us? He didn't care about the sleeplessness. He didn't care about the pain. He didn't care about the cost. All he cared about was the love that he had for you and I and has for you and I. So motherhood has a powerful beauty that is comparison to God's love. It's very similar to the pain that Jesus Christ endured in order to birth us into the family of Christians. So ladies, you do relate to Jesus in a way that we don't relate quite the same. Right? Thank God that God is lion and lamb. Lion, lamb. Men, women. I love that. Psalm 127 verse 3 says, "Behold, children are the heritage of the Lord. The fruit of the womb is his reward." And it's your reward, ladies. That's why, by the way, I am so praying that our Supreme Court goes ahead with the reversing Roe versus Wade. Now, what people don't understand is it's not making abortion illegal. It's giving it up to each state. And people are like, well, I think it's good. Okay, you want that. But why not make it a little bit harder and not because it's an inconvenience? What's my choice? Well, how about you choose not to have sex? Well, how dare you, Pastor? Okay, well then be careful. Mother, may I tell you that unlike God's love, a mother's love, although it has some similarities, God's love is perfect and a mother's love is imperfect. Sometimes a mother's love will enable, which is not good. Do you realize God never enables? It tells us in Proverbs 3:12, because the Lord disciplines those he loves. Some moms, I run into this. Little Johnny, little Sally, now all grown up or semi-grown up. They have nowhere to go. Mom, can I stay with you? And what they bring with them is a girlfriend or a boyfriend that they are having sex with outside of marriage. Sometimes they bring with them drug use. And the mom will go, but I love my little Johnny, little Sally, whomever. I can't just leave them out in the street. Listen, if one of my kids came to me, I love my kids, and said, Dad, I need somewhere to stay. I'd say, okay, is this with your girlfriend or with your boyfriend? Yeah, you're not sleeping together in my house. Yeah, I'll let you have a room, separate room. But if I find out y'all are whatever in my house, you're out. And by the way, you're going to go to church. Really? Yes. Well, I'm tired. Then you don't want to live with me. And you're not doing drugs. Because if you are, then you don't. If you got money to spend on drugs, you can go get a place of your own. But you're not doing it in my house. Do I love you? Yes, I love you. I love you. I love you. But you're not going to do that. Whoa. Dad, that's a lot you're asking. What do you think? You're going to live. I've got to pay for electricity and the food. You get the idea. Listen, if they really need my help, then they're willing to do because I really want to help them. Without God, they're not really getting help now, are they? And what I'm doing is enabling. Mom, Dad, if this is you, stop it. You're hurting your children. There's a quote that says, there's no way to be a perfect mother, but a million ways to be a good one. You and I, we can't be perfect parents, but we can be good ones. We can be prayerful ones. And we cannot put our stamp of approval on sin. You are causing more damage than helping your kids. And we do that in the name of love. But that's not really love. God is love, and he says he chastens those he loves. Also, by the way, ladies, because this is your day. when Father's Day comes, I'll get the guys. Sometimes the connection between a mother and a child can be so strong that it becomes ungodly. Moms, you cannot put your children before your husband. I see that all the time. When couples come and say, we are staying together for the children, well, that's your first problem. Not that you're staying together for the children. You should be staying together because of God, and you should be staying together because you love each other. The kids should, because here's the thing, everyone's going to have emptiness syndrome. If you're living for your children, you're preparing yourself for a letdown when they're gone. They are not your identity. Jesus is your identity, and husband is the head, and the wife are one, and the children will grow up and leave the nest and need to be left to leave the nest. Those are two very important things that we need to cover when it comes to love. But a mother's love, as beautiful, it can also be tragic. Erich Fromm said this, the mother and child relationship is a paradox. In a sense, tragic. It requires the most intense love on the mother's side, yet this very love must help the child grow away from the mother to become fully independent. See, I say this all the time. The first step your baby takes is the first step away from mom and dad. The mother holds the child's hands for a short time, but of course a mother holds them in their heart forever. But we have to recognize there's a time to let go. Mary had to let go. Mary saw Jesus grow from a baby to a toddler to a teen to a man and then to a man on the cross. She had to let go. Jesus' first step was a first step away from home towards the cross. Your baby step is a first step to being independent, not carried in your arms. And that is hard to deal with. Letting go of love is so, so hard. But you know what I love? It's not the same, though, between us and God, right? Jesus Christ went to the cross so that we could be born again. The only difference is with us, each step that we take in our new baby, you know, we become newborn Christians, every step we take is closer to our home, not away from. I love that about God. So, man, we must realize that our moms, our sisters, our brides were created with a different kind of love. Listen, a mother's hug lasts long after she lets go. One person said this, life doesn't come with a manual, it comes with a mom and a dad. But it's important that mom and dad get their cues from the Bible, because you are the manual for your children. You are the guidelines in which they are going to operate until they're on their own. So prayerfully, you are a mom today who prays for your kids and lives according to Scripture. There's a song I ran across by accident, and I was like, wow, how perfect. Let me read you the lyrics. It's called Look Like You. And it says this, I just want to look like you. This is a young girl singing to her mom. I just want to look like you when I'm knocked down and tired and still have the fire. Look like you when I'm in pain, push through it. Always be someone who, in the darkest days, still lighting up the room. When my world wrecks me, when life tests me, I don't want to know what to do. And I don't know what to do. I hope that I look like you. If we didn't have enough, I never knew it. Even to this day, don't know how you do it. All the scars that you have that no one can see, always so strong even when you were weak. If I'm half the person you are, I'll be enough to get through anything. That's so good. Listen, I miss my mama. She was a strong lady. She was a joyful lady. She prayed for me. She gave birth to me. And then I became a real pain. She prayed. She left a legacy. John, 1 John 4:16 says this, God is love. And God is a three-letter word for love. Guess what? So is mom. So you have a mom, she loved you. She loves you. If you're a mom, you know you love your kids. The one thing we need to never do is take moms for granted. So let me encourage you. If your mom is alive, call her. And if you are a mom, I pray your kids call you. But one thing we know, that all you women have a special kind of love in you, and we appreciate it. So God bless you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for moms. Thank you for women. Thank you for the ladies. Thank you for their sweetness and their gentleness and their softness. Thank you, Lord, that this world isn't just full of testosterone. That'd be horrible. But thank you, Lord, that you give balance. And so, Lord, today, of course, we see the parallels in your sacrifice, Lord Jesus, and the sacrifice that a mom makes. So let us say thank you, Lord, to our moms and the moms in our lives, our sisters, our neighbors, our, the ladies who have endured a lot. And Father God, may we be grateful, because it all comes from your hand. Because you, Lord, are so good to us. And so are our moms. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you're here and you need prayer, we've got some deacons up front that would love to pray for you. If you're missing your mom, that's a good time to pray. The rest, hey, how about we sing one last song from our heart to the Lord? Let's rise and sing.
all is done.